He's not a member. Okay, good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Board of Selectmen's meeting for Tuesday, March 15, 2016. We will start the meeting with the Pledge of Allegiance. This is the opening of the public session this evening. The board starts tonight an executive session where we discuss deployment of public safety personnel and equipment or strategies with respect thereto. We'll open the meeting as we always do with a public session, public forum. Residents are invited to share ideas, opinions, or ask questions regarding town government. Do we have any takers this evening? Okay. Seeing no one, we'll move to consent agenda, which is three items tonight. Common victual license. The Board of Selectmen will consider approving a common victual license application from Tony Groutsis of Marathon Pizza, 30 Main Street, Hopkinton, for a fast food sandwich and pizza restaurant with seating and takeout and delivery. Number two items, a one-day liquor license. The Board of Selectmen will consider approving a one-day wine and malt-only liquor license from Hope Helberg, owner of Bittersweet Company, on behalf of the YMCA for an event on April 5th, 2016, from 5:30 to 7:30 to be held at 28 Main Street. Third item is gifts. The Board of Selectmen will consider acceptance of two gifts, one from the New England Laborers Training Trust Fund in lieu of taxes in the amount of $5,000 to support the town's tax relief fund for senior citizens in Hopkinton, and another gift from the New England Laborers Training Trust Fund in the amount of $5,873.90 for a one-year lease of the police department's motorcycle. Would anyone like to break any of those items out? Okay. Chair, I'll entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda.
So moved.
Motion second. Further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, present, not voting. That's unanimous. All right, moving right along. On to tonight's fun event. The Board of Selectmen will consider approving proclamations for the following Eagle Scouts of Troop 1, Hopkinton, Mass. Oh, my thing just exploded. Trevor Perkins, Roderick Landreth, and Matthew Paolucci. Do we have a Scoutmaster or anyone? You want to come up and introduce us, or?
Sure. Yeah, just one correction.
Please.
Roderick Landreth is going to
be. Oh, right. Samuel Darko, got it. Chair's fault. I got it. Okay. Up to the podium so we can see you.
So it's my pleasure to introduce three new Eagle Scouts from Troop 1 in Hopkinton. First, we have Matt Paolucci, Trevor Perkins.
Hi, Trevor.
And Sam Darko.
Great. Okay. Well, why don't we bring them all up one at a time and come up here, introduce yourself to the board, tell us what you did, and we'll grill you mercilessly. So.
Hi, my name is Trevor Perkins. I'm thrilled to be up here tonight, and to be even considered for this is an honor. And for my project, I designed and helped cut a connector trail from Whisper Way in Hopkinton. If you don't know where that is, that's kind of like, it's down near the bridge, but before St. Paul's Church. That's where I describe the area. Where it's located, and the trail runs from Whisper Way to Cameron Woods. It's a 0.2-mile connector trail. And during the project, we started initially by cutting trees and smaller shrubs off, especially in early April when there was still snow on the ground. Then later, as the project moved into the next phase, we kind of worked on getting kind of the smaller leaves and rocks and debris scattered along the trail. Around May, we raked the entire trail. And the trail is kind of, it starts flat, and then it kind of goes up on an incline, and then it levels off and goes down again. So we raked the entirety of that. After the trail was raked, all the debris and extra material was cleared. We then added trail signs and barriers to mark where the trail was. And around May 17th, the project was complete.
Right on. Thank you for that detailed description. Okay. Mr. Catino, any questions for Trevor?
Yeah. How many people did you muster to help you pull off this task, and how was the management of it?
So in terms of scouts, I got, I think, around 14 or 15 people, scouts overall, with usually around 4 or 5 scouts showing up. I also had some friends and some family members help out around the project, so it probably was around 20 or 21 people overall, and it combined for about 74.5 hours of total service on the project.
Excellent. Yeah, congratulations with this. Yeah, this is as the chairman said before, this is our favorite thing to do, is to you know, raise you Eagle Scouts. And it's just amazing, you know, the management that you have to do, and you think these are small projects, but to manage, you know, 24 people to pull this project off in such a short period of time is a really great accomplishment. Congratulations on this. And keep doing well in Mrs. Stimos' class. And you do a great job.
Mrs. Astari.
Trevor, not only congratulations, but thank you. You know, you and your friends here, your fellow Eagle Scouts, You're coming out and you're finding ways to give back to the community, and I think that that's a lesson that very few people learn at your age. I didn't learn it really until I was in my 30s. And for you to be starting out so young and giving back to the community and encouraging others to give back as well, that's a great thing. How did you, I guess, get these other folks to help? You know, did it take a lot of cajoling or?
So in terms of how I organized people to start help on this project, every week I would send out weekly email correspondence saying what the project session would be. Most, if not all, the project sessions were held on a weekend, usually on a Saturday or a Sunday morning, so that it was accessible for people to go. I also, when doing the project, I would kind of assign people things by age and based on kind of varying ability level. So for the younger scouts, I would often have them use, you know, the smaller clippers and things that were more of their ability level. But then, you know, older scouts, I had them use the saw and had them clear some heavier rocks and whatnot, just because it was better to kind of delegate the tasks that way.
So this was all volunteer on their part, too. You kind of put a sign-out sheet up there, a sign-up sheet, and they came out. That says something to your character as well, the fact that people would come and they'd be looking to help you achieve one of your goals. So congratulations.
Thank you.
Mr. Mosher.
What was your biggest challenge during the project?
I think my biggest challenge during the project was often kind of having to plan. Like, you could make a plan for a given day, but then you could have circumstances in which that plan would totally, you'd have to change it and make changes right on the fly. I know that distinctly for me, as I kind of mentioned before, when I first started out the project, there was snow kind of all over the ground, and I wasn't really sure how to anticipate that because I had kind of set a timeline based on the months and days that I would start the project. So we kind of just had to say, we're just only going to cut off kind of the bigger trees rather than kind of getting down to the nitty-gritty on the trail. Other times, I think the challenge was communication. I described how I sent out my weekly email correspondence. Sometimes I didn't send out the correct information or would need to resend that information. And so I think that's another thing I learned about it, that you kind of need to be 100% precise in your communication and know exactly what you're going for.
Great. Well, sounds like great experience, and really appreciate your efforts. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Hart.
Trevor, what grade are you in?
I'm a senior.
Senior
high
school?
Yep.
Have you taken a public speaking course
now? I've never taken a public speaking course.
You should. You're a paying plus.
Thank you.
Well done. So tell me, are there how many volunteers that are on your team?
So I had around 15 scouts and probably 20 members of friends and family.
Anyone ever call in sick? Or?
No, I don't think nobody ever called in sick. No, everyone worked great. They worked cohesively. I was really impressed. I also think sometimes I'd have less turnout than I anticipated, and that was okay. We were just able to make do with what we had, so it ended out working fine.
That's great. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Trevor, an awesome project. I mean, very. I like trails. I think that's terrific that you did that. And from a management perspective, it's quite impressive. You're able to get that many people together, herd all those cats. I could actually use some lessons here if I wasn't leaving in 8 weeks. So thank you very much for that.
Thank you.
We'll cut to a proclamation here in a minute.
Hey, so it's an honor to be here for you. My name? Okay, my name is Matthew Colucci. it's an honor to be here before you tonight. So my trail, my project was a trail. It was off of Cross Street. It's called Brook Hollow Trail, right next to Brook Hollow Road, by the Faith Community Church. And the project was given to me by Hopkinton Area Land Trust, Holt. It was originally given to her son, but he was so busy that he was unable to finish the project. So when I was looking for one, they handed over from him to me. And basically what I had to do is I had to go through the trail. I had to it was completely overgrown, so I had to trim away all the overgrowth, which was mainly poison ivy. And then there was two benches that were in not prestigious condition, and they had to be knocked over. And then we had to put two new benches where those two old ones had been knocked down. And we cemented in the posts to make them more secure. And I decided to build a third one in this area that I thought could use another bench. So Halt was fine with that. And then I had to reroute part of the trail. The whole thing was around like 3/4 of a mile long. So it was very, very interesting, especially getting all the people there and the experience of leading and all that.
Matthew, that's a big project, 3/4 of a mile. Holy cow.
Yeah.
That's a long trail. Huh. Mr. Mosher, any questions for Matthew?
I don't know if we could enlist them for some road work around that.
Yeah, exactly. Volunteer.
What was your favorite part about the project?
Favorite part? Probably the benches. Making the benches was interesting because there was so much more to it than you would think. There's a lot more steps about how the grain of the wood was facing, how to pour and make the cement, which I already knew, but there's my dad does a lot of stuff like that, so he was always teaching me a lot of things, because I would have done them all wrong had I just been in charge of doing the benches on my own. So, yeah.
Your father was right.
Yeah.
No, he's just wrong in a different way.
Well, that's great. Thank you very much. I look forward to seeing the project.
That's good. Mrs. Astar.
I would have made the benches wrong, too. that's great. You know, and for anybody who thinks that maybe we don't have all that many trails in town, and I'm not saying we have enough, but, you know, try to maintain them. And, you know, year after year, we have these scouts coming in who are not just maintaining them, but helping to make them better. And it's things like this, you know, putting the benches, clearing trails out. It's not easy work. It's work that a lot of folks don't want to do in their backyard, never mind out in the middle of the woods with poison ivy and things like that.
You can't dig the posts in the ground when there's rocks as big as your head.
Exactly, right? And so what are some unique issues that you had to get around and things like that? And how'd you do that? How'd you figure it out?
Rocks was one. We had to reposition one of the benches. In fact, one of the legs is a little further apart than they should be in between, but not so far apart that the bench would just snap, but like when you sit on it. But we had to accommodate for that. One of the larger problems, though, was the poison ivy, because we were trimming it all down, and we actually mowed over it at one point, and that worked. And then we went on vacation and came back, and it had all regrown. So then we decided to just take it, remove it by hand. So we decided to just pull them all out, and my 8-year-old grandpa came over and started pulling them out too, so I had to give him extra credit for that. So yeah. One of the hardest problem for me personally was preparing the whole thing. Preparing it takes so much. You have to think ahead so much. And I would not have done the project without Mom. Mom was the safety net a dozen times more. Yeah, so lots of planning that goes into it. You have to plan the food, you have to plan the supplies, you have to plan what who's going to do what, and if they're done with that, what are they going to come to you and ask for, and what are you going to be prepared to give them?
So. Right, great. And do you have any businesses that helped out that you'd like to thank?
I was donated some wood for the benches, bench legs by Hopkinton Lumber. They told me not to put a plaque there in their name so that people wouldn't see that the wood was donated, else more people would come for donations. So I was like, okay, fine, that's okay. Yeah.
A little too much honesty there, man.
Yeah.
Scout's honor.
Yeah. Can you ask a question?
Nice job, Matt. Nice job. Yeah. And congratulations.
Also, the plaques were done by NUC Trophies. NUC Trophies, yes.
Great.
That's awesome. Mr. Herr.
So we are televised live, Matt, and this also runs on tape. So tell me, you mentioned...
Nice.
You mentioned Paul in your presentation, the Hopkinton Area Land Trust.
Yes.
How was it working with Paul?
Good. It was nice working with them. They were very positive about the whole thing. Very excited for it because they have so many trails that they know about in Hopkinton. So it's always great to know that Eagle Scouts are coming along to help and reestablish these trails. I visited them a couple times, and they wanted binders and stuff. I actually have a binder here that I can pass around. Here, I can actually.
Thank you.
So it's amazing all the different things that these young people learn when they're going through these projects, and just to have them sort of download all that information in the last 5 minutes really is spectacular. So well done. Congratulations. Thank you for your improvements to the community. And this is something that will carry with you for the rest of your life. And
oh, yes.
You'll be amazed at how this will help you in the future in job applications, school applications, you name it.
So definitely.
Congrats.
Mr. Catino.
So what advice would you give next year's Eagle Scout if they're going to take on doing a trail? What would you do differently, or how could you help them out to make that setup process or the whole project go a little smoother for them?
It really is easy if you can plan it all out. It's just the planning that's difficult because... there's just so much, you'll miss things, then you'll forget some stuff, but like you have to set out like, okay, well, here's the date that this is going to happen, when am I going to hand this in, and then when you're done with all that, you can work on the project, and when you can work on the project, you come up with like, okay, when am I going to set this up, what's going to make people want to come, Dunkin' Donuts, you're going to bring donuts, because they like donuts, so you need to have food and beverages, then you need to tell them exactly how long it's going to be, because you don't want to make the meeting too long. For them and tell them what to do, what to bring. It's just basically all comes down to being prepared.
Oh, tied it right back to the scout.
Yeah. Yeah, excellent. Well, congratulations. Great job. You're going to see that putting this on your resume is going to open a lot of doors for you for the rest of your life. Great job.
Thank you.
Thank you, Matthew. That's great. Sam.
Hello, my name is Samuel Darko, and it's an honor to stand here in front of you. I worked on a half-mile to three-quarter-mile trail next to Fruit Street Fields. It went from the fields themselves around to the road that led to fruit to the road that led to the fields. So the trail itself included a 14-foot bridge, and I was tasked with clearing the trail, leveling out the front of it because there was a giant mound of dirt that was blocking the entrance or made it hard to get into. There was lots of trash on the trail because it was close to a public area that needed to be picked up, and I also had to put markers along the trail to direct people.
Okay. That's a terrific. I actually walked that trail. I know which one you're talking about. That's a fabulous little one, the loop that goes there. Very nice. Mr. Herr.
Does that go out the back corner of the field?
Yes, it's. So. Do you know the soccer fields?
Yeah.
So as you're entering into the fields, there's a trail off you'll see a sign that says Mary C. O'Brien
this
Pratt.
This is the Mary Pratt Trail.
Oh, okay, gotcha. And then, right,
yeah.
Right. And as you're going in, it's also on your right. So it kind of, it makes kind of one a shape like this, and then the trails be up here.
I have not run that trail yet, but I've run others in that area, especially when I'm kind of going after the little bits that are top of Fruit Street. Yeah. So I look forward to running it. Well done. Thank you very much. I love running that area. Kids are on the fields playing. I go for a run, so it's a good use of my time and get to see the kids down there too. So thank you for putting it in. It's a great area in which to build a trail. And I have the one we'll use it. Thank you.
Mr. Mosher.
How long did it take you to actually from start to finish?
So when I first started, it depends on whether you're actually talking about working or actually looking at it, because I started looking at it in February and I wasn't able to actually work on it then, but when I actually started setting up times for people to go, it was probably about two and a half months. So.
Was it more work than you thought it would be?
Yeah. Yes, it was. It wasn't so much more work physically. It was the fact that both me, Matt, and another, Eric Landreth, who was supposed to be here tonight, all three of us had projects going on at the same time during the summer. So coordinating between the three of us, all right, I've got this weekend. Next weekend it's supposed to rain, so we can't do anything on that weekend. The weekend after that, you know, Matt's got to go. So the three of us together had to coordinate when we were going to have our own weekends to help people come and help work on our trails.
It's a lot of donuts, I'm sure.
Donut competitions.
Appreciate your efforts very much.
Thank you.
Mr. Catino.
That's even better. Ben and I were just looking at each other. That's even better that the three of you guys had to coordinate between yourselves and the helpers and everything else. You know, that's you know, getting to be, you know, acting like CEOs and everything else. That's great job, you guys. Is there anybody that you want to thank that may have given you wood or shovels or any of that, or the donuts?
I want to especially thank Halt for giving me this trail that I could help repair and make it usable again. And Hockton Lumber gave me what it cost.
Oh.
And they weren't
very generous.
Yeah, they asked where I was from, so I was Troop 1. They're like, oh, so back again.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, because I guess you know, I'm on the Upper Charles Trails Committee, and it's just great hearing that these trails are all being reconditioned and made well again. So thank you very much. Again, great job.
Thank you.
Mr. Sestari.
You mentioned a bridge on the trail. Did you have to do anything in particular with that bridge?
Oh, boy. Oh, yeah. So one of the main issues was in the river itself, there were a whole bunch of downed trees that we had to remove so that it didn't block the bottom of the bridge. I used a 14-foot-long planks by 1 foot to create essentially beams across, and one side was a lot higher because there was also a root that elevated it, meaning that we had to take out the entire root and help level that side so that it wasn't as lopsided. And constructing the bridge itself was difficult because you can't transport that much wood in a minivan in one trip. So it was also very difficult because, you know, measure twice, cut once. Well, make one wrong cut and, let's do this entire thing again.
Two more times.
Yeah. But part of Westcats is we can't operate power tools. We can use a screwdriver. So it was very nerve-wracking seeing my dad use a circular saw when if he makes a wrong cut or if I have it measured right or something's wrong. I mean, you know, it's a very delicate process, but I'm glad that he was able to help out. And putting the bridge together on the site with younger scouts there and hammers and nails, being just supervising, making sure nobody's going to poke their eye out, and making sure people had proper safety gear, eyewear, gloves, everything on, make sure everybody's staying safe and everybody's aware of everybody else around them, is another huge challenge of just constructing the bridge itself.
Did you see any beavers out there?
No.
No?
Oh. Wish.
Just wondering, all the downed trees. Yeah, well, that's great. Congratulations. And, you know, as the chair said earlier, this is one of our favorite types of nights throughout the year. And I think the community is blessed to have several of these each year between the Boy Scouts and the Girl Scouts. It never ceases to amaze me that the youth in our community are striving for such high levels at whatever they do. So thank you very much.
Samuel, great job. Really, having been the trail, it's terrific. I'm very excited. So for all three of you, the Board of Selectmen, actually, we're quite proud of your achievement. It's genuinely something that, as you get older and you look back at it, you'll realize what an impressive thing it was you were able to come in here tonight and do that and tell us all about this. So the chair will entertain a motion to approve proclamations to read as follows. The Town of Hopkinton, Hopkinton Board of Selectmen, hereby recognizes Eagle Scout recipient Samuel David Darko, Eagle Scout recipient Matthew Cole Paolucci, and Eagle Scout recipient Trevor Learned Perkins, of all of Boy Scout Troop 1, Hopkinton, Mass., Boy Scouts of America. Therefore, the Board of Selectmen of the Town of Hopkinton, Massachusetts, join with each of their family and friends in recognition of his achievement in attaining the rank of Eagle Scout. Signed under our hand and seal this 15th day of March, 2016, Benjamin L. Palico, Chair, John Catino, Vice Chair, Todd Sestari, John Mosier, and Brian Herr. Okay, motion? To approve those proclamations?
Second.
Motion second. All in favor?
Aye.
That's unanimous. The proclamations are approved. Gentlemen, congratulations.
I just did.
Yes.
Thank you.
All right. Nice, it's all downhill from here.
Kevin, how far have you gone?
Oh, man. It took me like half a day, but I did it.
I'm at 12. Yeah, I know.
You need your book back.
Great job. Well done.
I thought he was coming up here to hang out with us the rest of the
day. Yeah, right.
All right, next item on the agenda, staff appointments and action item. The board will consider confirming the town manager's appointment of Deborah J. Irvin as interim library director for the Hopkinton Public Library. Mr. Kamalo.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Although we are appointing Deborah Irvin on an interim basis, I felt that given the visibility of the library director position that I presented to the board, and I would be amiss also if I did not point to the process that got us here. I can share with the board and the community that this is a decision that intimately involved and counted on the input of the outgoing library director, Ronak Hussein, as well as her team. Specifically, when we learned that Ronak was intending to retire, she gave us the opportunity to meet with her staff, and through consultations with the library team, we arrived at the decision to go with an external candidate after giving our internal staff the opportunity to step up to the plate. The reason that they gave was the fact that the library department is going through a significant transition, and therefore they were looking for somebody specifically with experience getting library staff ready to transition into a new facility. Against that background, I am respectfully presenting Deborah Evin. Deb, I should mention, Deb, we may be asking you to do some trails in town too. She's a town resident. Yeah, she's a town resident. And the references that we spoke to identified her as supremely qualified. She worked as the assistant library director for the town of Concord for 3 years before retiring. Prior to that, she was the reference supervisor at the Framingham Public Library for 14 years. And before that, she was the head of reference and information services in Manchester, New Hampshire. We also heard that in terms of how you're rated, everybody rated you as a 10. This is on a scale of 1 to 10. You are the person that that we want to meet the public in the library. You are one of the best, loyal, ethical. In terms of your professional strengths, we were told of your problem-solving skills, that you are wonderful with patrons and staff. You're particularly skilled with difficult or unsatisfied customers. You work well under pressure, very focused and productive, very mature and responsible, and above all, you have a can-do attitude and always carry yourself with dignity and always pleasant to everybody you meet. So with that background, I'm asking the board to affirm Deb Evin as the town's interim library director.
Hi, Deb. Can you come up to the podium and maybe introduce yourself and the board can say hi to you?
I have to say I have a frog in my throat.
That's fine.
I won't leave. But my name is Deb Irvin. I've lived in Hopkinton for 11 years. And every morning on my way out on 135, I've wished that I could stay here and do something for the town. So the old saying is, be careful what you wish for. But I'm happy to help with the Hopkinton Public Library. We're in exciting times right now. As you know, we just broke ground for a new building on Friday, and we said goodbye to Ronak Hussein, who has done a fantastic job, not only in moving this project, but developing the library, developing the staff. I'm really pleased to have such a wonderful team to work with.
Well, thank you for coming in. It's very nice to meet you, and let's see if anybody has a question. Mr. Sestari?
Welcome.
Thank you.
And congratulations on being able to stay in town through your days now.
Thank you.
You have significant experience, and over the years, have you seen any change, in the past decade, resulting from the internet and e-books and things like that? And how's your service adapted to that? Not asking how you'd apply it to Hopkinton, until you get in there and really get yourself embroiled in what's happening. But what are some of the changes that you've seen in how libraries service the public?
Well, as a reference librarian most of my life, the internet really helped us to do our jobs better. And that included having online library catalogs, which were networked by many towns, like we have here in Hopkinton with CW Mars. And it gives people an opportunity to share the wealth, if you will, to share materials. We don't all have to buy the same book. Mm. And the internet has also helped us to move beyond what I call the farmer librarian. We always had certain books in our collections, and that is what we could offer people. But now, we don't have to have the materials in our library. We can help people find a state law and print it out so that they can take it to defend their traffic ticket. And we don't have to have that collection because it's available online. So it's really helped us change how we do things in a better way, I think.
Great. Thanks.
Mr. Catino.
Yeah, I just, looking over your resume, I think it's great that you, Concord, you're working with the physical plant issues and strategic planning, because with the with the new building, it's going to be punch lists.
Yes.
And to be able to speak the language to the custodians and the construction people. And then the other thing I noticed that in Framingham, you were overseer of the local history collections. And we're going to have a beautiful bench at the library that you can look over. It's you've got some great stuff in your resume. Thank you very much for stepping up. You're going to love the short commute. I went from an hour and a half down to staying in town.
I love it already.
Yeah. 3-minute commutes are awesome.
Thank you.
Mr. Mosher.
Welcome to the Hopkinton Library.
Thank you.
You're going to be part of a great team. It's one of my favorite places to go is the library. Well, the building certainly has limitations, the staff never has, and they've really been kind of the heartbeat of downtown, I think, from a community aspect. So I think you're stepping into a great situation. I think you'd be a great addition.
Thank you. Thank you.
Mr. Hahn.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining the team. I'm sure you'll do a great job based on your resume and your background. I think this is going to be a perfect win-win situation for you and for the town. So we're excited to have you on board. Quick business question, if I could, please, Mr. Chair. Mr. Kamalo, is this one a, not this one, just the position, is this a 1099? Do we do 1099s, or is this a full hire? Is it a consultant?
I think we're paying a per diem rate based on an hourly rate.
Okay, as a consultant, though, not as a...
No.
As a hire?
Yes.
Okay, okay. And what about the process for the full-time, long-term position?
In fact, that's one of the reasons the recommendation from the library team was to go with an interim external candidate so that we give ourselves enough time to find the best qualified candidate. In other words, we're not going to rush the process. We have somebody who's experienced. We have somebody who we're hoping is going to help us better prepare for the new facility. And I don't see that process getting off the ground in the next 3 months.
Does the individual this evening, is she allowed to apply for the long-term position? Has that been decided?
That was one of the points of discussion, and we have gathered from her that she absolutely has no interest in applying, but she will continue to help and volunteer for the library if need be.
Great. Sounds fantastic. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Deb, really happy to have you here to help keep the ship, you know, sort of moving forward. As Mr. Moser said, it's a great time at the library. It's one of our favorite institutions, and so I'm sure you'll do a great job of helping us continue to keep it on its high level while we move, you know, make all these preparations to move ahead. So thank you for volunteering to help. So with that, the chair will entertain a motion to affirm the town manager's appointment of Deborah J. Irvin as interim library director.
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed, not present. That's unanimous. Congratulations. Thank you again. Looking forward to seeing you there. Okay.
Thank
all
you.
Set. Now, tonight's next event, Marathon Committee presentation, discussion action item. Hopefully they'll hear me. The Executive Director of the Boston Athletic Association, Thomas Grilk, and Marathon Committee Chair, Dorothy Ferreter-Wallace, goodness, will give an overview of the marathon activities for the 120th running of the Boston Marathon.
Welcome. Coming down to the deadline for the big day.
Exactly.
Everybody's been working so hard, and I have to commend everybody on the Marathon Committee, all the public safety officials, all the department heads. I mean, everybody has just worked so graciously with time and effort with the BAA. The BAA has been unbelievable. The race organizers, they just top shop, and it's been a pleasure working with everybody, and especially the Board of Selectmen, the town manager's office. It seems we always have a few things that we want to change from here to there, but this year it looks like pretty much the same footprint. There may be a couple of minor things, but pretty much we're just going to go. It was so successful last year. I mean, we'll just have to have one of you put something in for the weather forecast, but other than that, it looks pretty good. And we're just so elated to have Tom Grilk, the executive director of the BAA, out tonight. I know he's inundated with meetings, as is. We also have Andy Deshane, who is the start operations manager, who does a wonderful job of helping us all and does a great job coordinating this event. The Boston Marathon puts Hopkinton on the map, but the thing that really is what binds everybody together, the excitement, the enthusiasm, and everybody just working together for a successful event year after year. And with that, I'd like to introduce Tom Grubb, Executive Director.
Thanks, Dottie.
Well, thank you.
Good time.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, good evening.
Welcome.
27.
I have nothing particularly earth-shattering to report. There is not a great deal of change that we're looking forward to this year, particularly as compared to last, the same field of about 30,000 runners, one of whom is with us this evening.
He's up to 12, Tom.
I got serious issues.
And the road closures and openings and all that stuff will be about the same. And Andy Duchesne is here and can address any particular specifics far better than I, should that be necessary. If anything has escalated, it is the level of cooperation from the town. We have yet greater certainty now as to precisely when we can make use of certain facilities here, school buildings, school fields, that sort of thing, so that there's no question who's going to be where, when, and that level of certainty helps everybody. We're very grateful to the town for all of that. The world will show up here again, as it always does. One thing that will be a little bit different, I guess, is that this is the last time that two members of the board will be involved for the chairman last time here. You've been here through some, as the Chinese curse might say, through some interesting times.
It's been interesting, yes.
And all those years in the United States Navy, I think, have been valuable to all of us in just helping to keep a calm and steady hand there when there's trouble.
Thank you.
And for Mr. Mosher, it was he and I in 2013 and 2014 who had to get together not much after the horror of 2013 and start talking about what 2014 would look like. And often it might just be sitting in the grass under a tree with t-shirts and flip-flops instead of my Class A head waiter uniform here that I have this evening to talk through what had to happen. And it did. Lieutenant Wallace is over here someplace, or there he is, who was part of that whole effort in his role then as lieutenant, then as interim chief. And we all had to make something happen as the world looked not only just over our shoulder but right straight in our eyes. What are you going to do? Can you people pull it off? And of course, it did work. And why did it work? It worked because it always works here, because everybody pulls together and makes it go that way. And that's what we saw from you gentlemen who have been here. And it was a magnificent effort. People looked and said, how does some little organization with fewer than 24 employees in a town on a hill someplace out in the middle of Massachusetts, how do they pull that off? Because many greater organizations and municipalities and governments have faced far lesser challenges and done not as well. But there's a spirit to all this that goes back over a long time and it continues. And we will miss you gentlemen as part of that. But you, like everybody, will remain part of this, and we'll all have that spirit for a long time. But we'll never forget, and always have as the most special, although in sometimes horrible ways, those moments of that year when we had to first deal with terrible tragedy and then decide how we could make it work again when there was lots and lots of reason to be afraid. Nobody was. And it's the opportunity to participate with the residents of Hopkinton and everyone else who plays such a role in this race that is so gratifying for us. That's why it sort of feels like coming home every time one shows up here. So if there are questions, I'd be pleased to address them. Andy, anything that you would like to point out here by way of logistics, things that will or won't happen?
So it's appropriate. I'm coming up. I'm the guy in the end with the broom cleaning up at the end of the race. Tom and Dottie both said it. you know, again, unprecedented cooperation, working together with everybody. It's fantastic. The unusual thing this year, there's nothing unusual about this year. It's really one of the rare times I could say we're almost doing a carbon copy of what we've done in the past. I was racking my brain before trying to think what was different this year than last year, and there really is almost nothing. We're using the Cultural Arts Center for a VIP program, but other than that, footprint, timeline, field, number of volunteers, everything all really the same. So I'm excited about that. It's not very often we get to just sort of dust off the operations manual and do it again. We are tweaking, of course, we're tweaking some things, little things here and there that most people won't see, but we're certainly always trying to make it better. So there's not really much that you're going to see that's going to be different this year. So. As always, my focus really is getting the runners out, but then immediately thereafter, making sure that this town looks spectacular when we leave. So I think I've said it before, one of my favorite things is, you know, the roads reopen and I'm looking around the common at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and except for maybe a trailer or a scissor lift, there's no way to know that there were just 30,000 people and who knows how many spectators there. It's one of the more gratifying parts of the marathon is when it's gone. So happy to be here, happy to help. Any questions, I'm always around. All kinds of folks here know how to get a hold of me, so just looking forward to doing it again.
Great.
Thanks.
All right, well, thank you all very much for coming in tonight. Tom, thank you very much for the kind words. It was very nice of you to say,
thank you.
I appreciate that.
Very much.
You got any questions, John, or thoughts?
I don't really have any questions, just I really appreciate your comments, and I was proud to be part of the effort and in the background as people collectively just went about doing what they'd done every year before that with some improvements and refinements.
Well, there's perhaps nothing better that can be said of any of us than that we made a difference, and you did. All of you.
Any comments for Tom?
Can I ask
for Tom?
A sort of off-topic question of the BAA? What's the BAA's kind of view and thought process around this movie that's being proposed or filmed now?
In fact, there are two sort of Hollywood films, but I'll address the first, the one of which you probably know the most, which is the one called Patriots Day, which is the one mounted by the director Peter Berg and Mark Wahlberg and now John Goodman. And that focuses principally on police activity on the day of the bombing and the days thereafter. There's a second movie that focuses on Jeff Bauman, who lost legs that day, whom Carlos Arredondo with the cowboy hat famously pushed in a wheelchair toward the finish, and that's being mounted by a different group headed by a producer director named Todd Lieberman, who you might know for The Fighter. For Peter Berg, you might know Friday Night Lights or Battleship or Soul Survivor. What has impressed me most in talking with each of those groups has been the respect that they display for everybody who was involved in that, for the people, for the resilience that followed the bombing, including instantly. So they are here, they say, and they've said the same thing to the city of Boston and the governor of the Commonwealth, to make something that displays great respect for what was done and displays admiration for what was done. So we are supporting those efforts in rather modest ways, but only insofar as public authorities say that they support it as well.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Okay. Any questions for Tom?
No, I'm all set. Thank you.
Good.
No, thanks, Tom. You know, obviously, you guys all put in incredible effort throughout the year toward the planning, even in the you know, quote unquote cookie cutter year from the prior year. You know, it's certainly a large task. You know, kind of trickling down, obviously there's the plans and there's the execution. You guys always execute your component impeccably. I know that you're never shy about also patting the backs of everybody else who executes their component as well, and I'm just going to take the opportunity. You know, you mentioned our public safety folks and the incredible level that they are involved each and every year, and right down to just the atmosphere that's here. And I know that over the last couple of years, everybody's always, you know, they want it to be safe, but they don't want it to seem like the town's on lockdown. And, you know, speaking from personal experience and interactions, you know, having watching some of the police officers in town, you know, welcoming small kids, you know, and offering them badges and, you know, things like that, it really does make it a more welcoming place for those people from around the world, like you were saying. You know, they're on their way, and, you know, they should know that Hopkinton's here with open arms and will continue to be.
Well, we are aware of the high standards that all of you set, and we feel obliged to do the best we can to try to meet them.
Okay. Tom, and you have a gift. Do you want to tell us, give us the news, or should I just do the acceptance already?
I yield to the chair.
You yield to the chair. Thank you, sir. All right, so gifts to the town. We have an action item here. In accordance with the Hopkinton Marathon policy adopted by the board on January 17, 2012, reimbursement for expenses incurred by the town in connection with the marathon is considered a requirement of the issuance of the parade permit. The board will consider accepting a gift in the amount of $118,000 to the town, along with a gift to the schools in the amount of, has that been determined yet, what the amount is?
$25,000.
$25,000 from the BAA in support of its efforts relative to the upcoming 120th running of the Boston Marathon, representing the BAA's contribution to the town over and above its reimbursement of town expenses incurred in connection with the marathon. So, can I have a motion and a second for that?
So moved.
Okay, motion and a second. Okay. Any further discussion on the gift?
Just a quick question. So this is in years past, this gift came after the marathon, and we had tallied up some numbers. Is this the 2016 gift, correct? Not the 2015.
This is that, yes. And I think for the past number of years, it has preceded the race so that towns would know.
I'm dating myself a little bit.
In the last 3 years, 3 years ago we made it, so they gave it to us in advance to get the permit.
Good. Thank you.
Okay. So we have a motion. We have a second for discussion. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, present, not voting. That's unanimous. Thank you very much. And I guess I can do this one. We'll use to here. Parking prohibition on marathon day and action item. The board will consider approving Police Chief Ed Lee's request to prohibit parking motor vehicles or trailers in all listed public ways in the town of Hopkinton from 5 a.m. to 1:30 p.m. the day of the Boston Marathon, April 18th, 2016, unless the vehicles have a permit issued by the Hopkinton Police Department. The prohibition will be enforced only in public ways critical to supporting the start of the race. Any unauthorized vehicles parking these areas will be towed. The prohibited parking areas are as follows. West Main Street eastbound is closed at 495 Wood Street, which is also Route 135, is eastbound is closed at Elm Street. Cedar Street, which is also Route 85, southbound is closed at the entrance to Hopkins State Park. East Main Street, which is also Route 135, westbound is closed at the Ashland Town Line. Hayden Row Street, which is also Route 85, northbound will be closed at Chestnut Street. Chestnut Street from the east will be closed at Route 85. Route 495, exit 21A will be closed. Ash Street North from Front Street will be closed at Blueberry Lane. All these roads are closed at 6 a.m. Any roads inside and around the above boundaries and any side roads feeding these roads are also closed to prevent traffic to the center of town and will be closed at 6 a.m. Can I get a motion and a second for that?
So moved.
Second.
All right. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
It's unanimous, so that's occurrence as well. Tom, thank you so much. It's been great dealing with you these past 6 years. I really enjoyed our interactions and look forward to another spectacular day.
Thank you. Let's all have a wonderful day.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Take care.
Yeah, but not last year. This time we're worried about snow. How are we going to get the snow banks down?
Get the snow out of here. All right, next item, fiscal year 17 budgets, a discussion and action item. The board will adopt the fiscal year 2017 comprehensive budget and submit to the Appropriations Committee. The board will review the draft 2017 annual meeting warrant and begin to take positions on articles. So we've done this now two meetings in a row the last 2 weeks where the board went through the budget. Had a lot of questions the first night and made some changes the second time. Mr. Kamala, can you just sort of remind that, and we have it in our package here, the proposed final version. Can you just maybe talk us through what changed since last time, and then we'll take some final questions from the board and we'll decide if we want to ship this off.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chair. In terms of the changes to the budget, I would like the board to take note of the following. The former levy was $58,298,214.75. Because of the addition of two items, namely park and rec subsidy at $192,161 and the personnel request that the town manager discussed with the board, totaling $189,900, and I do have an explanation as to how we arrive at that number. and an increase in local revenue estimates of approximately $177,000. The revised tax levy is $58,502,916.75.
What's the delta?
Trying to do a quick calculation. 58,542.
It was 59,884. It's
58,294.
Mr.
Chair.
Yeah. Yes, Mr.
So, what is that? What does that then correlate to in percentage impact, net of new growth?
Yeah, with those adjustments, they projected a net tax impact is 3%. And there was also, specifically with regard to the personnel changes, I would like to share this with the board, which is an explanation as to how we arrived at the 189,900. Thanks, Brian.
Oh, thanks.
You recall there was a specific question from the board in terms of how we will fund the proposed new positions, taking into account existing funding in the town manager's budget as well as the land use department relative specifically to the assistant town manager position. The document that I just shared with you identifies the proposed positions and the requested amount. And then the next segment explains how we get there and how we arrive at the 189,900. Specifically, we had the assistant town manager position at 125. Together with the other position, that totals 314,900. We, in terms of buckets and how we move the monies around, we had budgeted approximately 73,000 for the operations assistant in the town manager's position. We're taking 10,000 of that and adding it to the principal planner position, and also taking the remainder to up the salary for the director of land use, permitting and planning, to cover her new responsibilities by approximately 15,000, and that leaves us with approximately $45,000 for the administrative assistant position, and that's how we get to the 189,900.
Mr. Kamala, could you tell me, I see that we're adding 10,000 to the principal planner salary. What percentage increase does that represent? And is that to comply with our salary plan that we have? And any other background you can give me on that?
Yes. The amount presented is for budgeting purposes. It's not the exact amount that will be applied to the position. That is something that we'll still have to negotiate with the principal planner.
All right, Ms. Kamala, let's just walk through this a little bit. So, because there's a lot of things we're going to cover here. And so, the administrative assistant to the town manager is a new position?
No.
Then why is it an ad?
Because we wanted to clarify that we are repurposing the remainder of the salary in the operations assistant position.
To an assistant?
Yes.
So you had the operations assistant in the budget.
Yes.
And now you're basically turning that into an administrative assistant role.
Yes.
Saving 25, and then you're putting 10,000 more into the principal planner, and then you're putting 15,000 more into, so you're basically divvying up the,
yes,
the operations assistant salary, more or less.
That is correct.
Okay. Now I understand. So it's So it's a trade. It's from one higher paid job to a lower paid job, and the net is still $70,000. Is what I think what you're saying. Okay. And then this document for the board that's titled Director of Land Use and Town Operations is the Assistant Town Manager.
Yes, and
we're calling it that because.
That's the title we circled for in our conversations in the office. We are open to the board's suggestions if need be. The board had asked specifically for the job description.
Mm-hmm.
As you can see, the job description provided accounts for the following. One, that this is a high-level management type of position.
Yep.
Secondly, it also strengthens the role that the position plays in leading the land use department. In addition to the land use department, we are asking the position to also supervise the animal control program as well as the weights and measures programs.
Oh, grueling as they are. Okay, so can we have consistency of titles where we have, if this is the title, can we make sure that this doesn't say assistant town manager? Can we strike all instances of assistant town manager?
If the board is inclined to support the position, yes, we will.
Okay.
We'll call the position.
Okay, so let's go to questions. Mr. Sestari, look.
I'm glad you just said that because I was confused.
That's why I brought it up.
I was wondering, you know, where the money for this is, and my question was, well, I guess I still have a question. You know, a year from now or 2 years from now, are we going to be getting requests from the planning board saying that they need another resource that's high level like this over on there?
I think, and with the chair's permission, Elaine, feel free to jump in here. My position on this is that the director of land use planning, the director of land use and town operations, will continue to play her oversight role in that department. So day to day, she will continue to be a factor. We also have the principal planner who is actually taking some of the responsibilities that Elaine had. And my discussions with the chair of the planning board is that there's the expectation that after Legacy Farms, the workload in the planning department will decrease. And thus, with that, against that background, we don't anticipate a need for increased staffing in that department. However, things may change in terms of the town's development trends.
And other than that, it's a net hike in taxes of 3%, which tells us that, not directly, but tells us that we are going into the excess levy capacity a bit this year, but it doesn't look like it's all that much. So coming out of this year, we're expecting $1.38 million in excess levy capacity still, roughly?
Yes.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
Mr. Mosier, questions?
I'd like to see a little more than carrying over 50 pounds. I mean, carry more. So I was a little confused also when I sat down and saw this and thought we were going to be talking about another land use director, and so kind of what was going on here. Thank you for the very detailed write-up and description here. I guess I'm just trying to formulate questions around this a little bit. So we're coming in at 3.0 right now.
Correct.
I don't think we've done a budget that hit 3 since I've been on the board. Do you recall, Ben?
Not that,
no. Anything over? So I think we're going to have to take another crack at this.
Start from scratch.
I should.
More of a statement than a question.
Yes. I should mention, Chris Sandini and I continue to look at the revenue projections. We have identified some funding that is available to offset, if this is allowable, and again, we're still researching this topic, that could offset at least or up to 100,000 of the library budget. This is money that we've received over the years as the library grant contribution from the state. However, as I said, this $100,000 that might be available, we're still looking into the implications of using it in the FY17 budget, and if that might impact the formula that is used to calculate the town's contribution to a public library.
Have we done that ever in the past? I'm not familiar with this grant amount. Have we ever done that before?
Yes. In fact, it's an annual contribution by the state based on at least, I think, four parameters. Mm-hmm. And in my discussions with Chris, it's an issue that we want to investigate further. It's the use of that fund is placed by Massachusetts law in the hands of the library director.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And we should also point out we're picking up a couple hundred thousand extra we're paying to OPEB this year as a catch-up.
That is correct.
So that's a sum of the delta. I'm sorry.
So I was just going to say maybe, I know we've gone through the budget, maybe Mr. Kamalo could summarize just some of the things that might be driving this that aren't exactly optional or driving it from an unusual standpoint, like insurance, like the OPEB. Are there other chunks of money out there that we might be making as an investment to offset future costs, or things we can't control that increased in an extraordinary way?
Thank you. I think, as you correctly point out, we do have fixed costs, contractual obligations, as well as initiatives that were identified by both the town and school teams.
Okay.
Is there anything specific beyond there's several big chunks out there, right? There's the OPEB, there's the insurance, or is this just kind of something that's creeping up across the board?
I think the huge chunk from an expense perspective is what we heard from John Westerling. There are two huge obligations that the town has to fund going forward.
Mm. Oh, that's $800,000 right there.
Yes, in terms of pavement management, as well as stormwater phase two obligations.
That's $800,000, $700,000 just by itself.
Okay, thank you for reminding me of that.
So big upticks, right, this year, public works, employee benefits and insurance, that's $800,000 uptick this year.
That's $800,000.
We really got hit on that one. OPEB is a big uptick this year, a couple $100,000. So, that's probably $1 million of stuff right there. Ms. Catino, questions for you?
That's actually 1.8.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's where I was going. Here it is, my second year on the board, and this is the first time in 6 years that this board has seen a three. And
did we blame you?
No. Maybe it's just the lame ducks, maybe.
Yeah.
I'm glad we were able to, get some of these numbers down, because people are going to ask. People are going to say, why are we holding the 2.5? And, and some of these things, those big ones that come to 1.8 million, we can't do much about.
In fact, if I may, as we review the past history, tax levy percentage increases, let's also remember that in the last, I think, 3-4 years, the tax impact that we've finally settled on at the time of setting the tax rate has consistently been lower than what was presented at town meeting, and we hope to continue that trend. Our projections are very conservative. The state aid numbers have not been finalized. As I mentioned to the board over the last two meetings discussing the budget, we are still engaged in negotiating the health insurance increase. And or fighting as hard as we can to get the best rate for the taxpayers.
Thank you. I'm good.
Okay. Mr. Herr.
So to that point, and I agree that the professional team has always done an excellent job looking under every rock as we get go into town meeting itself and even when we come out of it through the fiscal year. But we never started at 3% going into it. I fundamentally have a problem with the 3%. The line in the sand for me is 2.5. I think it's we did the underwrite and we tightened our belt because we had to, and we talked about it at that time that we weren't going to do it so we could spend it later. We're going to do it to leave it in the pockets of the taxpayers. So I think we're close here. I think you've done an excellent job. The team has done an excellent job. And I support the structure and the initiatives that are underway. But I am convinced that we can find a half point somewhere so that we don't go above what the taxpayers reasonably would expect be their impact overall. So I'd like to see us figure it out. I mean, we talked about the last meeting. I said we're going closer to 3% than we're going closer to 2%. I'd like to see us go closer to 2%, and we have gone to 3%. So this isn't news to anybody sitting in the room tonight. I would just like to draw that. I'm going to draw the line and stand at 2.5, and that's where I'm voting.
I will know we do. It's all driven by the operating budget increases, right? Everything else is down this year. There's some very dramatic increases in many of the operating budget lines. It adds up to 3.7 million dollars almost. Whereas everything else on a year-over-year basis is actually down a bit.
The community's growing. And it's growing, I think, at a pretty rapid rate. And I understand the pressure on the budget, and I understand the need to staff accordingly and to organize in a way that makes the most efficient sense for the community. That said, I still think we can do it inside what would be a normal tax year for the taxpayers. So there's a challenge in that. I understand that. But I'm sure that Mr. Kamala and his team can rise to the occasion and make it happen. I don't want to get into the weeds about, where 20 grand's going, where 30 grand's going. I think he has demonstrated over the years a clear ability to manage to that level. And I think as a policy board, the policy should be, this is the tax burden we're acceptable, that's acceptable, work it out. And if that's, I think, where our decision-making should end. And then the rest of it should be left with the professional staff to make it work.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else have any following comments?
Ideally, I'd like to see us come to under 2.5%, but I also want us to be sensitive to some of the issues that we've run into in the past decade, where we have pushed off maintenance and capital expenses and maintenance of our buildings, our cars, and tools of that nature. And I don't want to see us fall into any similar situation where, 5 years down the road, 10 years down the road, all of a sudden we have to start putting in larger sums of money again into our infrastructure. So while I will certainly be on board, let's try to get this back under 2.5%. It should be the goal. If we feel as though it's going to come at an expense of starting to push maintenance off in any way, that's where I'll have to hear more before I accept it.
I will also point out one reason this is, I'm just looking through the numbers here again and looking at the offsets. Free cash is down a lot. Right, so we're losing $5.5 million in free cash that we've usually been able to use to offset the tax rate. I mean, I guess I hear you, Mr. Herr. I'm just trying to figure out where it's going and where it's coming from. And if you look at the increase, it's basically just factual. It's basically half schools, $700,000 for all the stuff the DPW has to do next year, and then almost $800,000 in employee benefits insurance, which I'm sure we'll squeeze on, right? So we'll bring that down. Outside of that, numbers didn't really move that, you know, moved very small. But then what happens is you've got a bunch of offsets that come down this year. So appropriations from free cash came down a lot. CPC money is down almost $800,000 this year. I think those things are, I think what I'm trying to say is the increase in the tax rate is driven by about five items from what I can see. Everything else is flat. And so what I'm worried about is if we do that, we're either going to have to cut the other operating budgets, but because they're small in comparison, you've got to cut them a lot, or we have to not do some of these things, for example, with DPW or something, or give the schools a lower number. I mean, everybody else is not up by very much at all. So I'm happy to have this conversation. I just don't know how to have it, and I don't want to just whack things for the sake of whacking things.
Yeah, we're looking at $300,000.
$265,000, roughly. $58 million, right? So $580,000.
Is a point.
It's a point. So $265,000 spread across.
Well, that's okay.
Entire operation.
We're also currently under a deadline of having to approve this and hand it over to appropriations.
So this isn't our final bite at the apple. We can send it along.
Right.
Appropriations can do it. It's my understanding. Sorry, Mr. Chair. It's all right.
Go ahead.
It's my understanding appropriations can do their thing. They can come back with a recommendation, then we can make a final recommendation at that time. So this isn't the last time this board sees it before it goes to town meeting, nor is it the last time that we have an opportunity to make a decision about what we're going to send to town meeting.
Right.
We can still adjust.
Mr. Kamal, how sure are you of this increase in employee benefits insurance? Is that really hard yet at this point? That's a big number. That's bigger than we've had almost ever, I think.
Yes. The number that, the percentage increase that is reflected in the budget, is the going industry rate.
Right.
But as we know, in past years, we've always come substantially lower than
right.
that number. And we're currently engaged in negotiations, and we're pushing as hard as we can. We will work on that aspect of the budget,
mm-hmm.
as we've done in the past years. We are also hopeful that the state aid numbers will come out different from the budget that was proposed by the governor.
Mm-hmm.
And so to the board's point, I think looking ahead, we may be in a better situation come town meeting. I'm also looking at this from the viewpoint that Mr. Pedro has pointed out. Really, we understand what is driving the increase. And then most importantly, I think the new expenses that are identified by both the school and town teams are expenses that I think are strategic. They help us in delivering our services much better.
Sometimes,
and
yeah, there's usually a pick up
also
there.
They reflect the growth in the community. And therefore, from my perspective, these are not avoidable costs. These are costs that we absolutely now have to build into the budget.
Right. Well, Mr. Mosher wanted to ask
just something. A quick question. We had spoken about the trash and recycling contract a couple meetings ago, and I recall the first time we talked about it, way before that, there was some significant savings in there, and the number 200,000 sticks in my head. I don't know if I'm misremembering or if that's still possible. I don't know if you finished your research since the last meeting, but if maybe there's a way to pick up some money through that.
Yeah. I've started my discussions with E.L. Harvey. We're looking at possibly four or five options. I can't get into details because we're negotiating.
Mm-hmm.
And potentially there could be savings for the town. But again, I think my overall point is it's going to be very difficult making any adjustments to this budget, considering that we understand the drivers. We also understand that the new expenses are responding to the growth in the community. And we remain very committed to providing quality services and at the same time finding efficiencies and savings for the community.
Let's hope it doesn't snow.
Amen.
Keeping our fingers crossed.
Mr. Sestari.
Yeah, so I just want to kind of review where we are right now. By the town charter, by the end of tonight, we need to approve a budget to hand over to appropriations. Right now, for us to hand over a budget that has no greater of a tax impact than 2.5%, we need to cut somewhere between $260,000 and $300,000. So if we're going to hand something over that complies with that that thought, we either need to dig in here and start looking at line item and start cutting it at the line item level, or we need to just create one large ad hoc cut and say, okay, we're lowering this whole budget by $300,000, or the alternative is for us to take a look at this. You know, we've been discussing the merits of the budget and areas where, you know, we have some issues, but vote on this, hand it off to appropriations as we do each year. They're going to be combing through this as they do at a granular level, and encourage them to work with both the town side as well as the school side to see if we can identify another $300,000 so that we can have that 2.5% or less impact on the taxpayers.
Okay, so I agree. I think we should do what basically you and Mr. Hurd just said. I think, I'm just looking at this, we can squeeze something out of insurance, I know. There's ways to, there's some more to get out of this. We can get this to 2.5. I think what we should do is more or less what you both said, which is we don't have to vote it tonight. We just have to vote to send it to appropriations tonight, right? So we could send it to appropriations tonight, ask them to review it, give them the insight, Mr. Manning, that we you know, our goal is to get this to 2.5, and then it comes back to us for final vote anyway, to Mr. Hurd's earlier point. And then if they get it there, great. If not, we have another conversation. We'll have had more knowledge because they'll done another deep dive on it and scrub some things. And we can get there then. I mean, this, to your point, this is not the last cut. So I would, I think that's a very good solution. And again, we've never had an insurance increase of that size, ever. And so I feel like that we're going to get a lottery ticket out of there anyway. So, okay. Does anyone else have any questions on the budget? Or otherwise, hearing none. Chair will entertain a motion to send the proposed fiscal year 2017 town budget to the Appropriations Committee for their review with a guidance from them that we'd like them to dive in and see if they can get the net tax impact down to 2.5%.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Further discussion? Good.
Nice.
Okay. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed, present, not voting. That's unanimous. Mr. Manning, over to you. Huh? What's wrong?
Nothing.
Oh, okay. Good.
You said nicely done.
Oh, thank you. Yes.
Oh, I thought you said I see none.
Oh, no, no. Nicely done.
No, I wasn't trying to shut anything down. I was just, I think we're all in the same place.
That was me.
This is
good.
Change.
That was productive. Okay, 8:45 p.m., which is not yet. Discontinuance of portions of Franklin Road and Peachtree is a public way. It's a discussion action item. It's not a hearing, though, so we can just get started. The board will consider referring this matter, even better, to the planning board for a public hearing prior to the 2016 annual town meeting. Is Roy here? Mr. Kamala, do you want to tell us what's going on? Oh,
yes.
Or the still director of land use planning.
Right.
Yes. Please, Elaine, go for it.
So as you know, the Legacy Farms North Road has been under construction, and as part of that, Franklin Road was moved slightly to line up with the new intersection. And so the dogleg over to East Main Street and Peach Street go away eventually and is replaced by the new roadway. So the planning board, at the prompting of the abutting landowners, submitted an article into the annual town meeting warrant to discontinue those old portions of the streets, retaining an easement for utilities that happened to be there, but discontinuing that, and eventually the land would go back to those abutting landowners who are interested in landscaping it and using it for their purposes. So as road commissioners, you could hold the public hearing, or you could refer the matter to the planning board to hold the public hearing. Public hearing is not required, but it's recommended to hear what the public has to say before a town meeting. So the question is whether you would like to hold the hearing or whether you'd prefer that the planning board hold a public hearing.
Any opinions? Anyone want to hold a public hearing on this? Sensing no urgent desire for a public hearing, go ahead.
Well, it's not an urgent desire for the public hearing, but on the one hand, I look and say that we're the group that accepts public ways.
Mm-hmm.
So we should probably be involved in the process that is giving them back as well.
Okay. Anybody else got an opinion on whether they'd like us to do this? What have we done in the past? Historically, what's been this?
We haven't discontinued streets for a long time, but when we did in the 90s, nearly 2000s, I think that this board did hold a public hearing.
Okay. I guess you make an excellent point. It's we're the road people. We should just do it. Okay. Mr. Kamalo.
Perhaps one way to look at this is borrowing from the street acceptance process, where the planning board prepares the report, presents it to the selectmen, and the selectmen hold the hearing.
Okay. Unless anyone has any objections, I say we just do a public hearing.
That's okay. Reasonable.
It falls under our prerogatives. Let's do it. Okay. Thank you. We don't need to vote that, right? You're just going to do it. Ms. Kamalo, I want to go back to the budget for a second. The article talked about reviewing the town meeting warrant. I just realized that there was no draft of the town meeting warrant in the package. Were we going to start going through that this evening?
Yes, we do have, and I should mention, this is very early in the process.
Is it in any shape to discuss, or should we just push it? I mean, I don't want to force it.
We can push it to the next meeting, but we do have a draft now. It's the warrant.
Yeah.
It doesn't have the numbers. The numbers come when we have the motions. But we are far advanced in the process of putting together the warrant this year.
Okay. Why don't we just put an agenda for the next... I mean, we've got to do this quick, right? So can we put a big chunk of time on the agenda next meeting for
next
that?
Meeting. Okay.
I'd really like to get through it as much as possible next meeting, and then any follow-up items or wrap-up stuff. We've only got two meetings left of town meeting. So we got to push through this. Okay. All right, so we're done with that. We're going to do the public hearing. Liaison reports, I believe, are next. Mr. Mosier.
I have none, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Herr.
Myself, Mr. Kamalo, and a couple of folks from the Senior Center attended a meeting with the MWRTA, recently. I think it was actually before our last meeting, but... had a good productive meeting, I thought, with the MWRTA in the hopes of accessing more public transportation in Hopkinton for the seniors and the population in general. We're talking about some route expansion. We're talking about some more visible bus stops so people know that we have a bus and where they can get that bus. And talking about getting an additional or replacement van for the senior center in particular, for the one that the MWRTA issued to us a few years ago. So I thought it was a very productive meeting, and with the growth in the community and the access or the need for public transportation growing along with the community, the timing I thought was very well. It was a good time to do it anyway.
Mr. Herr, is there already a need for a replacement? I'm assuming there is.
Yeah, they have a schedule that they follow.
Okay.
And then what will happen is, so we get the van, quote, for free. We give the van that we have back to the MWRTA. Then they use that as a backup vehicle for their fleet and for other things. So there is a schedule that they follow. I think it's 90,000 miles. Regardless, it's a good program for Hopkinton and one we think we want to expand. And it's the MWRTA that's expanding.
Right.
Not so much us.
Right.
Okay. Mr. Catino.
You know, last week with the Director of Land Use Planning's help, we convened the Irvine-Todaro Land Use Planning Committee
don't know what's the acronym for that one. That's a really strange one. That we formed the committee and started talking some basic uses for the land, but we're going to be meeting again in another 10 days, I believe.
Terrific. Mr. Sestari.
No, I took the last 6 days off.
Okay. Mellon report is we had a phenomenal groundbreaking on Friday for the library, which is well attended and a great good time. So looking forward to starting to break some things there and get it rebuilt. So that was a good event. And we have no invitations, right, for the board this week?
No invitations.
Okay. Town manager's report, Mr. Camallo.
Nothing to report at this point, other than to thank HR for their role in getting us the interim library director, as well as letting the board know that we should be ready to provide an update on the fire chief process at the board's next meeting.
Okay. And we should probably talk about this some more, too. It got caught up in the budget part tonight, but let's maybe next meeting have a little more of a discussion about this and just make sure everyone's kind of good with the job description. This is going to be a question at town meeting, I'm sure, and so we should really have it well thought. All right. Future board agenda items. Mr. Catino.
None at this time.
Mr. Sestari.
Nothing at this time.
Mr. Mosier.
Pending Mr. Kamala's research, can we talk about the recycling again?
Yes. Mr. Herr.
All set.
Chair, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. It's unanimous. Good night, everybody.